I guess we have a question from us. I guess one of the thoughts from one of the earliest speakers. So they talk about whether technology is really a barrier for the elderly to use. People may come, for example, a lot of the elderly, they use FaceTime, talk with their grandchildren, you know, they're on the Facebook,
Right.
they're doing this, and they're like, do you feel like technology is a barrier for these elderly adoptions on the telehealth, where you feel like it's not really?
Well, you know, like I mentioned, it's if it's easy to use and seamless to use, like Facebook, and I think it really took off after the touch screen, right, with the iPads and whatnot. It became really easy for them. Handling the mouse was an issue. Once the mouse went away and once we got the touchpad, the usability really improved, and consequently their adoption of the technology. So that makes sense. It's just even with telehealth, as long as they do the expected steps, it is easy for them. A lot of older adults use telehealth if it's just as easy as, say, pressing a button. But if they try to do something else beyond it, that's when the problem arises. And you're talking about healthier, right? In terms of Facebook, the interaction starts and completes with that one-time conversation, right? It's purely pleasure and leisure. But healthcare is different. It's not just this data, but what do they do with the data in their day-to-day life? Because they are really sick, and they need to, if they need to use the data to make changes in their life, it is the thing is, the impact of telehealth has to sustain long beyond just the data collection. And that's where I think telehealth is breaking down. Because if they just take their vital signs, press a button, everything is fine. But if they really try to do something with it, go back, try to get some more data, then it's not easy. It is not easy because they hate going through multiple screens, and they just don't have the patience to dig for information that a lot of younger people do. Like, they spend tremendous amount of time digging for information. Older people don't have that patience, so it has to be made easier for them.
Okay, so you made an interesting point. So if there's no touch screen, your prediction is that Facebook and they will not take off within the elderly community. Really,
yeah.
That makes, you know, quite a sense in there. It's good. Hopefully we then continue. Maybe that one of the recommendations for you is just for all deployment in the elderly setting, you have to have a touch screen, whether it's a laptop or tablet.
I mean, I'm hearing a lot. Recently I was at some aging lab, and that's what I heard, that touchscreen highly increased the engagement of these old adults in technology. And earlier they would just struggle with the mouse and, you know, navigating the website. But touchscreen just changed all that. And so, but that's good, right? But we're talking about things beyond just the face conversations.
Yeah. How about, what's your intuition between, let's say, a touchscreen like an iPad versus just like a nice big Dell or Lenovo, you know, like a all-in-one screen, but also has a touchscreen, so it's on your desktop? Do you feel like between those two form factors, is there any, what's your intuition in the usability of that for the elderly?
I didn't get the second one. What's the second one?
Okay, the first one is something like an iPad you could hold in your hand versus something like big monitor that's also a touch screen, or a laptop that's touch screen.
I don't think it matters.
Okay.
I think that doesn't really matter. You know, I mean, it's ultimately it's about the processes involved, whether you're in your hand or on the desktop. It's the processes involved that to get to the data and what they do with the data. And that is what needs to be improved in telehealth. Touchscreen definitely has improved a lot of just getting through the first step, like that barrier is gone. But if they want to do something more beyond just pressing a button or taking their measurements, that's where the processes need to improve. And that's to do with the screens, you know, with the algorithm behind what happens once they collect the data. So to me, it doesn't really matter if they are doing it on hand or on desktop. I guess it doesn't matter. Yeah.
Got it. Okay. So one of the your slide, you talk about sort of loneliness of this where the there. So what are you thinking about in terms of like the Amazon smart speaker? Now I have this sort of voice-based interface talking. Do you feel like that's enough to have some impact on the loneliness, where you really have that, like, you know, need a real people interaction.
Sure, I think so. I think, and I'm not sure how successfully that's being done, but that's really a need. Not only, I mean, and you have the technology to do it. A lot of these people can travel, right? So not only can we use telehealth to have this face-to-face interaction with providers, but even face-to-face interaction with their own peers, right?
Yeah.
Like some kind of peer support counseling session, because they can't, they're too frail, they're too tired, they can't, they don't have driving privileges. But then we can use this telehealth to have this kind of peer support session where they can encourage each other. They can be socially there for each other and also encourage each other to continue with the with their health management using telehealth. So those kind of aspects can definitely be brought in telehealth. Like I said, a lot of the time that I work with to do with telemonitoring models, where all they do is have this box where the patient sends in data. And that seems to fail these patients in terms of social isolation, and so that's where that's where the model needs to be looked into more.
Got it. That makes sense. It almost feels like if you just have these sort of box to collect the data, you really need to. That would be a failed design. You really need to have some sort of screen, maybe an iPad to go along, so you actually can sort of make that adding the social.
Yeah, exactly. And then if you have that, sometimes people, it seems in healthcare, they're just so busy. And I've also had that, like in the beginning, they used to have this, but of course, those days they had poor network connection. But even then, the healthcare provider said, we're just so busy. Like, we really don't have the time to chat. We need to be prioritizing on the higher level healthcare crises. And so I'm, but we have a lot of lower level care providers, a lot of aides or nursing aides that can be perhaps used for these kind of situations so they can address these issues. But telehealth definitely has a potential here. But again, I'm talking utopian model. I don't know if there's any reimbursement for things like these.
Yeah, they probably request an innovative startup to come with some economic model. I guess Kavita might ask is, so let's say you were to, suppose the setting is a set of senior populations, you know that loneliness is a key issue in there. Again, these are seniors that, let's say, living by themselves in their own home.
Mm-hmm.
What would be the clinical protocol, or whatever the things you are doing in terms of, do you have a top three things you would do that you would really just have a big impact, in terms of the loneliness? Like, let's say you're in charge of this program, what would you do? What would you implement?
In terms of telehealth, using telehealth?
Yeah, telehealth, even just overall, just in terms of help against just,
Right. Help. It's good. It just that right now it's not anybody's priority or focus right now, even though it's such a big issue getting people engaged in it. But one thing that I keep hearing a lot is that they really like support of their peers. So maybe some kind of peer connection or peer network, right? I mean, that's the reason why Facebook is so popular. But some kind of peer network connection with people in their own situation. So I think that's something that I would facilitate to telehealth. And then perhaps have some health aides visit them once in a while, check on them, get in some family support. That's just a lot we can do. In fact, we even at UT, they even did some research where they use Skype with patients receiving Meals on Wheels. So these Meals on Wheels patients and just using Skype for providing this kind of mental counseling. And they found some really good outcomes in these patients.
Yeah.
They were doing much better psychologically. But again, they never got funding after that because it just didn't seem to make a big impact, right? Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. I think a lot of this great idea, unfortunately, because there's no economic reimbursement model. It's a little bit stuck there. We have an audience question from Gandhar. He says, so for example, what are some of the pitfalls you expect for telehealth that involving things like self-administration of exercises? So, for example, certain patients that had to go through sort of physio, sort of therapy at home. Do you see, what are some of your thoughts on that?
That is good. So I'm focusing just on seniors, right? But in typically, I mean, I'm hearing a lot of good positive results about therapy in general, physical therapy in general, especially for the younger population, where you have this one physical therapist and then they can just do the therapy at home. I think there is a lot of potential in it. That's definitely a great idea. And even in heart failure patients or any cardiovascular patients, you have something like cardiac rehabilitation. It has been shown beyond doubt that cardiac rehabilitation drastically improves outcomes, and yet people just don't show up. Only 30% of people recommended for cardiac rehab show up. So then there is, and cardiac rehabilitation requires exercises. So in that case, definitely there is value in using telehealth for exercise monitoring. But then when you're talking about older adults, there needs to be that careful monitoring as to how much is too much, because you don't want them to overexercise. You just don't want them to go into a health crisis. And there needs to be very precise recommendations of what is the safe limit of exercise for them. And if there is adequate resources in terms of attending to any crisis right away, then I definitely see a great potential in such an idea.
Yeah, okay. Thanks for that. I guess one of the big topic in the senior care is like dementia in there, right? This is, you know, mm-hmm. this extremely complicated case. You know, what are some of the things you have seen in terms of best practices involving like using maybe telehealth, even a mixture of telehealth plus physical care in terms of like, you know, like addressing this dementia issue?
I mean, once the dementia has set in, I think the major priority is keeping them safe. So I do hear of sensors such as fall detection sensors or to stop them from wandering. So they have these tags on them. And so if they're wandering, then they can be found right away. There are RFID tags on them. And then if they had a fall, then they can be. So there are definitely these sensors. And I guess some people like it, but my sense is it's not really the best solution, because again, there are a lot of other issues too that's going on. I mean, it may take care of probably one or two issues, but if there are 10 or 15 issues going on with the dementia patient population, it's not taking care of that. I mean, if there is unruly behavior or disruptive behavior, we don't have a solution for that in terms of telehealth. But I am definitely seeing value. I think a lot of providers, especially the caregivers, the family caregivers, like this idea of being able to track them and, detect any problems with their safety. But the other fallout is some other people have argued, like, what does that do to the dignity of this patient, right? I mean, this seems like Big Brother is watching you, that's always watching you. But sometimes if people prioritize safety over dignity, then they prefer telehealth.
That makes sense. I think, it's a really hard and complex choices in there.
Yes.
You actually mentioned a lot of these were really complex and tough challenges, you know, the issues you mentioned in your presentation. So what are some mm-hmm. of your ideas for solutions for, like, you know, to go out for these
right.
some issues? Yeah.
Like I said, one of the issues that I can't cover is the fact that healthcare system by itself is not perfect, right? Mm-hmm. Our healthcare system. So, I mean, that just needs to be fixed with all those issues such as interoperability of data, clinicians just communicating properly. But my take on the biggest impact that's going to make is to actually empower patients themselves. I think even now we have a system where we treat patients as, not as equal partners in their care. Mm-hmm. So we telling them what to do. It's still very condescending towards them. We mm-hmm. tell them what to do. We tell them how to live. And mm-hmm. that's just not sustainable.
Yeah.
I think unless they are made an equal partner in their care, unless we can motivate them to take good care of themselves, it's just not going to be sustainable. And telehealth, surprisingly, if it's done well, it can be a great motivator for behavior change, because it gives that contextually relevant data that patients can learn to use for their behavior changes. But if that's not done well, if it's just all about data, And if it's just all about telling them what to do, then sooner or later they're going to lose interest. So I feel one of the biggest things that needs to be done, it's not just on the technology, but what happens outside of the technology, is how do you use the technology to make the patient, the older adult, an equal partner in their care.
Yeah, I really love that. And I feel like there's a bunch of these were startups created. Their premise is you need to almost like talk down or dumb down the tech. It really is about taking the respect out of the treating. Then I think that would be, it's pretty demoralizing in there. I think if you have like any sort of research data suggesting, you know, like the, you know, the impact of getting the patient involved, the kind of respect, I think that would be, you know, huge impact on the industry. Definitely, I would say maybe share with us after the session. We can post on our website for people to read.
Right. I think there's a lot of research happening right now and just in those kind of things, you know. So now I think people are waking up and using these kind of behavior change theories, melding it with technology interventions and trying to find out just exactly how is it that empowered patients. And therefore, I mean, there are some research here and there that does show that empowered patients have better outcomes than patients who are not empowered in their care. So we have that.
Okay, that makes sense. So in terms of like the so all from your experience, from the research side, your personal experience side in there, so what would be some of your most important recommendations to the audience in terms of like when using telehealth technology for the elderly?
I think the most important recommendation, I mean, there's just so many, but one of the most is just trying to figure out what their context is, like what their living situation is. What is going to work? We cannot assume like a one-size-fits-all. Mm-hmm. I think trying to figure out what their living situation is, what their context is, what their other diseases are, and then incorporating that into a system to create a tailored solution. I mean, without much effort, you know, just like just taking care of the basics and having processes to take care of this patient context, I think will really help in getting the patient engaged. Because like I said, like things like depression, a lot of the times they're not screened for depression. And if the patient is depressed, they're not going to do anything, right? They're not even going to measure themselves on telehealth. All they might need is a simple prescription. And then you know, it's going to do a whole, I mean, they're just going to give them a whole new different worldview. So I would definitely strongly recommend looking at that patient context before something is implemented.
Got it. That really great. I think that context really is, in some sense, resonates for me quite a bit. And on my design, where in the end, right, if you don't have the context, you really is just like drawing blind in there. You're going to make choice in there.
And the other thing is, I don't know what is the industry standard in terms of usability testing. But instead of just testing in the lab-like setting, mm-hmm. also to have some field experiments. And maybe that is the case, but just to actually recruit real targeted audience and to do like a field setting in their home, and that kind of usability, I think, will go a long way in making it, you know, what we call it elder-proof. So we make it, you know, such that anybody can use it, but use it responsibly.
Yeah, that makes sense there. I guess I was getting close to the end of our session there. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of really excitement in the whole the elderly care telehealth space in there. So if you were to do a, let's say, startup in this space, like what would you do? Like, is there any
thought? Well, my startup, for me, I mean, I've been thinking, you know, this is what is my research area right now, and I've already mentioned it a lot, is definitely to bring that behavior change aspect here. You know, like how do you get the patient involved with their data and how do you motivate them for the behavior change? Because I think that kind of empowerment or that kind of engagement, making them an equal partner, is the only way we can make these kind of elder, you know, technologies more sustainable to get the you know, all the relevant stakeholders in as part of the data. Because as we see, even things like Fitbit, I've heard that they're not used after 30 days of use, right? I mean, after 30 days or so, they're all being neglect technology. That's the problem. There are a lot of these elder technologies, senior technology, but really the goal is what is it that's going to make them sustainable? And that's why the vision needs to be beyond just the technology, but really to find out what's meaningful to that older adult. And
okay.
So, but it's not easy, right? It's very difficult. So I don't know how we can come about technology like that. Yeah.
Hard topic. Because
yeah.
So I have three final questions as we close the
okay.
session. First question is, so if the audience members can learn only one thing from you today, like what would it be? Like, again, you share many things, but if they're like, what is the most important thing, like you want the audience to
The most important thing is patient context is really important. Tailoring to patients is very important, and make them a partner in their care. It is their health, right? It is their body. They need to know about it. They need to be a part about it. So that is definitely, you know, and it's across the ages. This matters even if you're a child. It matters if you're an adult, and it all the more matters if you're an older adult. So. Yeah, that's the main take-home point that I would say.
That makes sense. That makes a lot of sense. Then the second question is, so what are something in telehealth that you believe in, but the rest of the world doesn't believe yet?
I believe telehealth still has a lot of potential in terms of. Right now, I feel its use is still restricted to kind of data collection or just having sessions, telemedicine sessions, consultation sessions. But it can have a lot of impact on psychological outcomes, such as it can, you know, like to reducing social isolation. So I feel like right now, its use has been restricted to a lot of medical use and a lot of actual psychiatric use, but it can do a lot in terms of improving psychological outcomes and behavioral outcomes. And there is a lot of potential there which has not been tapped. So, yeah, definitely I believe that needs to be still looked into. And I believe that there is potential there.
Not great. Then the final question is, so you know, today on the Capitol, they're voting on the new health bill in there. I know this health is pretty political size, you know, back and forth.
Yeah.
I put away the politics in there. And if you could whisper one or two ideas into President Trump's ear or planning his mind, like what would be that one or two idea you want to plant in his mind?
Sure. Yeah. No, I think, and this is again just for, but preventive care is better than reactive care, right? We need the resources to prevent crisis than reacting to crisis. So there needs to be resources available for people to access healthcare before things get too bad, you know, and they need to get regular checkups. And definitely, I would strongly recommend preventive care to President Trump. And also being a researcher, we are constantly struggling with funding for patient-centered outcomes. And because researchers, of course, business outcomes are important, but then we need funding for research like that where we are looking at true patient outcomes, what's meaningful to the patient. And it might not necessarily be business fiscally viable as yet. Maybe that's potential later, but we need funding to test out such radical ideas. So yeah, absolutely, I'll strongly recommend continued funding. And I think, and I this is not related to telehealth, but it's kind of having a hybrid approach where there can be better pay for the kind of lower rung of the healthcare workforce, like say the nurses, aides. You know, they actually do the grunt physical work of taking care of these older adult population, but they're so lowly paid that their quality suffers. But at the same time, they are that human presence that helps these older adults. So to have a system where we can hybridize telehealth use for specialists and use better use of this kind of, I think that would be fantastic.
Yeah. That sounds wonderful. Again, thank you so much, Kaviti, for joining this webinar. And for the audience, unfortunately, we didn't able to get to all your questions, but we're going to post the answer to them after the session. We can record that. Again, thank you so much for sharing your
Thank you
insight.
so much for having me. All right. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.